Dress to Kill, 1980 film. Dress to Kill is a 1980 American erotic thriller film written and directed by Brian De Palma and starring Michael Caine, Angie Dickinson, Nancy Allen, and Keith Gordon. It centers on the murder of a housewife and an investigation involving a young sex worker who witnessed the murder, the victim's teenaged son, and her psychiatrist. The original music score is composed by Pino Donaggio. Kate Miller, Angie Dickinson, is a sexually frustrated housewife who is in therapy with New York City psychiatrist Dr. Robert Elliott, Michael Caine. During an appointment, Kate attempts to seduce him, but Elliott rejects her advances. Kate goes to the Metropolitan Museum of Art where she has an unexpected flirtation with a mysterious stranger. Kate and the stranger stalk each other through the museum until they finally wind up outside, where Kate joins him in a taxi. They begin to have sex and continue at his apartment. Hours later, Kate awakens and decides to discreetly leave while the man, Warren Lockman, is asleep. Kate sits at his desk to leave him a note and finds a document indicating that Warren has contracted a sexually transmitted disease. Mortified, she leaves the apartment. In her haste, she has left her wedding ring on the nightstand, so she returns to retrieve it. The elevator door is open on the figure of the tall, blonde woman in dark sunglasses wielding a straight razor. Kate is violently slashed to death in the elevator. A high-priced call girl, Liz Blake, Nancy Allen, happens upon the body. She catches a glimpse of the killer, therefore becoming both the prime suspect and the killer's next target. Dr. Elliott receives a bizarre message on his answering machine from Bobby, a transsexual patient. Bobby taunts the psychiatrist for breaking off their therapy sessions, apparently because Elliott refuses to sign the necessary papers for Bobby to get sex reassignment surgery. Elliott tries to convince Dr. Levy, the patient's new doctor, that Bobby is a danger to herself and others. Police Detective Marino, Dennis Franz, is skeptical about Liz's story, partly because of her profession, so Liz joins forces with Kate's revenge-minded son Peter Keith Gordon, to find the killer. Peter, an inventor, uses a series of homemade listening devices and time-lapse cameras to track patients leaving Elliott's office. They catch Bobby on camera, and soon Liz is being stalked by a tall blonde in sunglasses. Several attempts are subsequently made on Liz's life. One, in the New York City subway, is thwarted by Peter, who sprays Bobby with homemade mace. Liz and Peter scheme to learn Bobby's birth name by getting inside Dr. Elliott's office. Liz baits the therapist by stripping to lingerie and coming onto him, distracting him long enough to make a brief exit and leaf through his appointment book. Peter is watching through the window when a blonde pulls him away. When Liz returns, a blonde with a razor confronts her. The blonde outside shoots and wounds the blonde inside, the wig falls off, and it is Dr. Elliott, revealing that he is also Bobby. The blonde who shot Bobby is actually a female police officer, revealing herself to be the blonde who has been trailing Liz. Elliott is arrested and placed in an insane asylum. Dr. Levy explains later to Liz that Elliott wanted to be a woman, but his male side would not allow him to go through with the operation. Whenever a woman sexually aroused Elliott, Bobby, representing the unstable, female side of the doctor's personality, became threatened to the point that it finally became murderous. When Dr. Levy realized this through his last conversation with Elliott, he called the police on the spot, who then, with his help, did their duty. In a final sequence, Elliott escapes from the asylum and slashes Liz's throat in a bloody act of vengeance. She wakes up screaming, Peter rushing to her side, realizing that it was just a dream. The nude body in the opening scene, taking place in a shower, was not that of Angie Dickinson, but of 1977 Penthouse Bed of the Year model Victoria Lynn Johnson. De Palma originally wanted Norwegian actress Liv Ullmann to play Kate Miller, but she declined because of the violence. The role then went to Angie Dickinson. Sean Connery was offered the role of Robert Elliott and was enthusiastic about it, but declined on account of previous commitments. Connery would later work with De Palma on The Untouchables. De Palma called the elevator killing the best murder scene he has ever done. Two versions of the film exist in North America, an R-rated version and an unrated version. The unrated version is around 30 seconds longer and shows more pubic hair in the shower scene, more blood in the elevator scene, including a close-up shot of the killer slitting Kate's throat, and some sexier dialogue from Liz during the scene in Elliott's office. These scenes were trimmed when MPAA originally gave the film an X rating. Dress to Kill currently holds an 84% fresh rating on Rotten Tomatoes based on 43 reviews for an average rating of 6.6 out of 10. Roger Ebert awarded the film 3 stars out of 4, stating the museum sequence is brilliant and adding, "Dress to Kill is an exercise in style, not narrative. It would rather look and feel like a thriller than make sense, but De Palma has so much fun with the conventions of the thriller that we forgive him and go along." Gene Siskel also gave it 3 stars out of 4, writing that there were scenes that are as exciting and as stylish as any ever put on film. Unfortunately, a good chunk of the film is a whodunit, and its mystery is so easy to solve that we merely end up watching the film's visual pyrotechnics at a distance, never getting all that involved. Vincent Canby of the New York Times called the film witty, romantic, and very funny, which helps to diffuse the effect of the graphically photographed violence. In addition, the film is, in its own inside-out way, peculiarly moral. His review added that the performers are excellent, especially Miss Dickinson. Variety declared, despite some major structural weaknesses, the cannily manipulated combination of mystery, gore and kinky sex adds up to a slick commercial package that stands to draw some rich blood money. Sheila Benson of the Los Angeles Times wrote, "The brilliance of Dress to Kill is apparent within seconds of its opening gliding shot. It is a sustained work of terror, elegant, sensual, erotic, bloody, a directorial tour de force." Pauline Kael of The New Yorker stated of De Palma that his timing is so great that when he wants you to feel something, he gets you every time. His thriller technique, constantly refined, has become insidious, jeweled. It's hardly possible to find a point at which you could tear yourself away from this picture. Gary Arnold of The Washington Post wrote, "This elegant new murder thriller promises to revive the lagging summer box office and enhance De Palma's reputation as the most exciting and distinctive manipulator of suspense since Alfred Hitchcock." In his movie guide, Leonard Maltin gave the film 3.5 stars out of 4, calling it a high-tension melodrama, and stating De Palma works on viewers' emotions, not logic, and maintains a fever pitch from start to finish. He also praised Pino Donaggio's chilling music score. When Alfred Hitchcock was told that Brian De Palma intended Dress to Kill as an homage to his movies, he responded, "You mean for homage?" Allen earned a Golden Globe nomination for Best New Star, but a Razzie nomination, as well. The film is currently owned by Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, successor to Orion Pictures, who bought Filmways and American International Pictures in 1982. The film saw a 1984 VHS release by Warner Home Video, and later another VHS release by Good Times under license from Orion. In 2002, MGM released the film on DVD, including special features. In 2010, MGM released both R-rated and unrated versions on DVD and Blu-ray. The Criterion Collection also released the film on Blu-ray in 2014. The film is recognized by American Film Institute in these lists. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.